I'm Steven Roy Goodman, host of Higher Education Today, a production of the University of the District of Columbia. Welcome back to the education program that connects you to contemporary issues, people, and institutions involved in the world of higher education. Today we'll be talking with former Senator Bob Graham about education, public service, and national security. Before becoming a U.S. Senator, Bob Graham served as governor of Florida and chaired the Education Commission of the states. As a senator, he chaired the Senate Intelligence Committee and became known around the country for work days in which he spent over 400 days doing the jobs of various constituents. Today, the Bob Graham Center for Public Service is housed at the University of Florida. Welcome, Senator.
Steve, thank you very much for this opportunity to spend some time with you and your audience.
Well, thank you, Senator. Yeah. Well, Senator, if we could start maybe, if you could say a word or two, what is the Bob Graham Center at the University of Florida, and what do you hope it will do in the future?
The Bob Graham Center is a program committed to citizenship. We are working with primary and secondary schools in Florida and increasing the level of civics education. On campus, our principal program is an undergraduate minor in public and civic leadership. We have 30 students a year who go through a program which emphasizes areas such as communication, economics, history, and ethics, as well as doing a significant amount of external activities, internships, and other things that get people directly involved in the program. It's my hope that these young people who are not likely to end up being career public servants, but are going to be citizens, they will be nurses, accountants, pharmacists, lawyers, doctors, who have in the back of their mind, at some point in my life, I'd like to give back through public or civic service, that they'll be motivated to do that, that they will do it effectively and honorably.
Well, do you think that enough students are feeling that right now around the United States?
No. There has been a sharp decline in citizenship among young people and older people in the United States over the last 40 years, and I think many of the things that people dislike about what's happening now, the excessive partisanship, the gridlock, the lack of civility, have some of their roots in the fact that we've now gone through more than two generations of Americans who have not been exposed to some of the fundamental principles of what it's like and what needs to occur to make a democracy a properly functioning institution to serve the people.
Well, but how do we balance the need, on one hand, to be civil, and on the other hand, to advocate for what we really believe in?
You can advocate for what you really believe in without becoming a screamer, yeller, or using despicable language to describe your opponent. In fact, I think that those kind of activities tend to divert people's attention away from the strength, the persuasiveness of the argument that you're trying to make.
Well, in speaking of disagreements that people have in terms of public policy issues, as the chair of the Senate Intelligence Committee for many years, I'm sure there are a lot of things you can't talk about on air, but as you probably know, there's been a big controversy in New York about the New York Police Department investigating students at universities outside of New York. How do we deal with that as a community?
Well, first, I'm very surprised about the investigations taking place outside the jurisdiction of the city of New York. I'm a great admirer of Ray Kelly, the chief of the New York City Police, and of the quality of the service in that city. But I think that service ought to be focused on that city, and if there's a need for other jurisdictions to take action, then the city might alert them and offer its assistance, but not preempt their responsibility.
Well, but let's get to this a little bit more if we could. It raises an interesting issue, which is if you're the mayor of New York or the police commissioner of New York, your primary responsibility is to protect people and property in New York. Mm-hmm. And if you perceive that there's a 1% chance of somebody doing serious damage, either to buildings, to killing people, don't you have to do everything in your power to stop that?
Yes, and you do it through the appropriate channels. We have a constitution that determines individual civil rights, and we have laws that allocate responsibility among the states and individual local jurisdictions. If there is a problem that is brewing in Newark, that may have spillover in New York, I would suggest that the role of the city of New York would be to alert, offer assistance, but still recognize that it's primarily Newark's responsibility to deal with it, or to bring in a federal agency such as the FBI to do a broader investigation.
Right, and when you were on the Intelligence Committee, I assume that you didn't always agree with all your fellow senators, and so sometimes there were disagreements mm-hmm. about how much you should protect civil liberties versus how much you should investigate people. How did you, without sharing national secrets on television, how did you try to resolve some of those disagreements with your fellow senators?
Well, by talking through what is it we're trying to accomplish. For instance, the issue of using excessive force, or the word torture, to achieve the goal of getting information. The fact is that that's been proven for at least the last couple of hundred years not to be an effective way to get reliable information. People will say almost anything to get you to stop torturing them. Whether what they're saying is credible or has any usefulness is another matter. So if you get people, my experience is that if you can get people to focus not on the process but on the goal, what are we trying to accomplish? We are trying to accomplish getting the kind of information that will assist us to protect the security of our people. Then you can have a serious discussion of how do you get to that end. Also, I think it's important to apply what I call the Alan Greenspan rule, that when you get into a discussion, everybody is entitled to their opinion. Nobody is entitled to their facts. We're going to work off a common set of facts and then see where your interpretation of those facts leads you.
Where do you see international students falling into this? Should we be treating international students differently than we treat American students?
The fact is, we do, and always have. They are not citizens or permanent residents of the United States, and therefore, mostly, they require some kind of a visa or other right to be in the United States. I think that's appropriate. What I think is damaging to the United States is to excessively deny young people the chance to come and study in our country. I believe one of the reasons, maybe the single most important reason, that relationships between the United States and our neighbors in the Western Hemisphere have improved so much in the last 50 years is that we've had a wave of young people from Latin America coming to study in the United States. We've had many young U.S. students go to Latin America in the Peace Corps or other kinds of programs. So we've gotten to know each other as human beings. And if you now are the Minister of Finance of Peru and you have a degree from a university here in the District of Columbia, you have a different attitude towards the United States than if you had never had that experience. So it's very much in our interest to see that there continues to be a strong flow in both directions of young people to better understand other cultures and societies. I think that's a fundamental contribution to the peace and well-being of the world.
Well, and I certainly agree with you on that. And in my professional life, as you know, when I'm not hosting the show, I'm helping a lot of students, both from Latin America and from the United States, come to U.S. universities. But as you probably also know, we're not the only people who have opinions about this. And there are a number of people who would argue that a number of students come from other parts of the other regions of the world. They come to the United States and they see a little bit of life here and then they don't like it. And they're actually worse off, or we're worse off than before.
Sure. I'm certain that there are people who have that experience, and they're probably young U.S. persons who have spent time in Latin America who come back and they don't like that. But I believe the vast majority are benefited by the experience. Young people tend to be very open and receptive to new ideas and understanding different cultures, and we need to take advantage of that receptivity. I'd been concerned from a recent visit to Chile, where our embassy told me that there had been a significant decline in the number of young Chileans coming to the United States, and they were going to places like Australia, China, Europe, in lieu of the U.S. Last week, I was in Lebanon, and I asked our embassy there what was the status of students coming to the United States, and they said that it had recovered and that now We were back to pre-21st century levels of students coming, so which I found to be a very encouraging statistic, and I hope that that is true globally.
Fair enough. And I guess one final question on this is, do you think we should be monitoring the phone calls of international students?
Not unless there is some specific reason. We have a statute called the Foreign Security Act, FISA, and it provides a means by which a government agency such as the FBI can get a judicially sanctioned search warrant to listen into your phone conversations. But just to do it casually without any legal structure or judicial supervision, I think is a violation of the U.S. Constitution.
And what about then monitoring all phone calls then?
No, that would be even more of a violation of the Constitution.
Fair enough. In terms of ACT, mm-hmm. You're on the board for ACT, which is, as you well know, and a number of our viewers know, is a competitor to the College Board. And the ACT has one of the most dreaded exams in the country. What are you doing on the board, and what are you doing to encourage testing to be a little broader than it has been in the past?
Well, first, I wouldn't use the word competitor. The fact is that the SAT, developed largely by the Ivy League institutions in the 1950s, is based in Princeton. The ACT was 10 years later, largely from the Big Ten, and it's based in Iowa City. I would say that we are collaborators in trying to assist the secondary and primary schools in understanding what's going to be required to prepare students to be successful at the higher education level, and then assisting the higher education institutions to make the difficult decisions as to which students are most appropriate for that particular institution. So I think we work together in a way that benefits the country. What are we doing now? One of my questions is, ACT is celebrating its 50th anniversary. We still administer the test basically the same way that we did when we started. That is a pencil and number two level pencil piece of paper in a school classroom on a Saturday morning. I think that we're going to have to move beyond that to some form of electronic test administration. There are problems of security of the information, but I believe those are we can deal with those problems. I think another more fundamental issue is, what do we test? What I'm hearing is that what society wants from its young people who've come through our education system is they want people who have good critical thinking skills. They want people who understand effective communications. They want people who have creativity. They want people who can work together in small groups. I believe we need to begin to adjust our testing to see if the students in their previous education have acquired some of those skills, so that then the higher education institution can build upon a strong foundation in those and other areas to assure that the student who comes out of college is very strong in those modern skills and aptitudes.
Well, with all due respect, Senator, I if you could deliver a message to your colleagues on the board, from where I sit, my students don't really feel that the SAT or the ACT is doing that. Okay. My students are scared of both tests. They believe they have to prep for those tests. They believe that they have to prep for them, and they don't know why they're prepping for them. They're not exactly sure what the tests are measuring. And of course, I have no choice but to recommend that students actually prepare for the tests.
Mm-hmm. Well, as a matter of fact, Steve, I'd like to sit down with you and maybe some of the leadership of ACT and talk about what you think needs to be done from your very direct hands-on experience. I have four daughters and now three grandchildren who are in college. So I'm going through this process of dealing with the SAT and the ACT, and I ask my daughters, keep a record of your experiences, and both good and bad, and share them with me, and I'm going to take them back to Iowa City and tell the people at ACT, here's what people like and dislike about the way we're proceeding. Here's what SAT, how it's being seen from the perspective of a parent and what we can learn from their experiences.
But in defense of the ACT, from where I sit, the ACT is more of a subject test, and from where I sit, that's a fairer assessment than just simply aptitude.
Yeah, the two systems grew up, as I indicated, one Ivy League and one Big Ten, and they somewhat reflect their origins. The SAT has been referred to as an IQ test, and the ACT is a test of your accomplishments and your educational growth. Those are both legitimate areas of inquiry. Students need to understand, and I'm certain colleges understand, what the meaning of the reports of accomplishment are as between those two choices.
Well, how could we encourage students to be more creative, in your view? High school students who are hopefully going to go to the University of Florida or another school like that, or Florida students who want to go off and have a career?
Creativity is probably one of the most difficult things to teach. Some people would say that a person like Steve Jobs became creative not because he learned it in classroom, because he either had it innately in his DNA or acquired it in some other manner. I believe that you can assist people in developing creativity. For instance, instead of giving students a lecture on a topic, you say select a specific problem that relates to the subject of the lecture and go out and see what you can do about it. And then have the students then have to go through the creative process of diagnosing what is the problem, who could help me solve the problem, how do I most effectively approach that decision maker and get my my problem resolved. I think engagement as opposed to passive sitting in the classroom is one of the keys to developing the skills of creativity.
Well, speaking of creativity, besides being a former governor and former senator, you're nothing if you're not creative. You've written a number of books, and I know you're here in Washington to talk about your books a little bit. Did you want to say a word or two about some of the books that you're going to be talking about while you're here?
Well, I'm principally going to be talking about a novel that I wrote it was published last year. It took me 5 years to write it. It's called Keys to the Kingdom, and it goes back to my service on the Senate Intelligence Committee. I came away from 9/11, as frankly have many others, with the concern that there were some significant unanswered questions. And many of those revolved around the issue of, did these 19 people operate as lone wolves, or was there some infrastructure of support that facilitated their ability to carry out such a complex and heinous plot as was we were subjected to on September the 11th. This book tries to provide some of the answers to those questions. Another book which I wrote and was published in 2009, quite different, is a nonfiction book called America, the Owner's Manual. This is a book directed at answering the question, what are the essential skills for effective participatory citizenship? If a citizen wants to be more than just a spectator in the grandstand and actually get down in the arena and make a difference, what do they need to know to do so? I would hope they would find some of the lessons of effective citizenship in here. And for your audience of people interested in higher education in the District of Columbia, the preface to this book is about a situation at Georgetown University in the 1990s when the local advisory committee was adopting some policies that were very adverse to the interest of students at Georgetown. First, the Georgetown students thought, well, there's nothing we can do, we just have to live with it, until somebody said, hell no, we don't have to just live with it. And they set up their own political party and took over the local advisory committee in the town of Georgetown. So that's an example of how citizens can make a difference if they know what to do and if they're disciplined and dedicated enough to execute on those skills.
What about a student who's just a little engaged? For the most engaged students, the Georgetown students who are organizing, they're engaged. The interns in your office, in your Senate office, they're engaged. They wouldn't bother coming. Whoever your legislative assistant for international affairs was before you left the Senate, was they care, and they care a lot. But what about the people who are just a little engaged? How do we get Americans to be a little more engaged than just the teeny, teeny bit that they are now?
Well, I'm going to start with what can be done in a school setting. I taught basically a course on America, the Owner's Manual, to a group of high school students for a full semester. We started the semester by asking the students to form themselves in groups of three. This goes back to that idea of collaboration in small groups. And to identify a problem in their school, in their community, that caused them some problems. And then to develop strategies to solve that problem. And that one third of their final grade was going to be given not on writing a paper about it or giving a class discussion, but how much had they actually moved the needle, made the problem less severe as a result of their actions. That's the kind of thing that I think gives young people a direct opportunity to learn how to and the fact that they can influence a policy. And once they've done it, it changes them psychologically. Instead of just saying, you can't fight City Hall, they said, hey, if I fought City Hall when I was 17 or 18 in high school, I can certainly do it now as an adult.
Fair enough. In terms of careers, in terms of particularly careers in intelligence, what would you advise students who are thinking about careers in intelligence? Do they send a letter to the CIA, or how does that work?
Well, the first thing I would do, I would go to some good source of who can guide me as to what I should be doing to make myself as strong a candidate as possible. Most of the intelligence agencies, such as the FBI, the CIA, the National Security Agency, have outreach to students. I can't tell you what their website is, but I'm sure they've got it there. What they're probably going to find out is that if you are oriented towards the technical side, they will direct you to some programs in physics and engineering. We sometimes forget that the leading edge of technological innovation in America for most of the post-World War II period has been the intelligence agencies. They were the ones with the Defense Department who basically developed the internet. So there's a strong need in that area. But in the area of operations, they're going to be looking for people with strong language skills, particularly in the areas of the world where we're most impacted today, which means the Middle East and Central Asia. So if you can master Arabic, Urdu, Pashtun, that makes you a strong candidate. Also, you probably want to do some area studies if you're particularly interested in the Middle East and Central Asia to take courses that will inform you as to the culture and the history, so that should you become a member of one of the intelligence agencies and that's your portfolio, you will start from a strong base of understanding of the region that you're going to be trying to understand and interpret for others.
Well, how supportive are you of then study abroad for a year or a half a year?
Oh, I think it's critical. I believe the way you can begin a foreign language in a classroom setting, but to really master a foreign language, in my judgment, you've got to be placed in a position where you do not have the option of lapsing back to English whenever things get tough. And that is in an environment where the other language is the dominant language. So I'm a strong supporter, and I think most language programs today have a component of overseas studies. I have a granddaughter who spent 6 weeks last summer in France and is now at the fourth or fifth level of proficiency in French.
Well, you may be interested to know, we actually had some guests on the show a few segments ago. There's a program in Seattle that encourages students in Seattle to study Chinese and Arabic, and they actually pay for high school students to go to China to study as high school students, not college students.
I would say that's a very enlightened program, and maybe you ought to give them some special recognition for for how visionary they are.
Well, they did come on, and I thought they were terrific. Yeah. We only have a minute or two left, so if I could ask you, what advice would you have for students who are thinking about elected office. I know we talked about civic engagement generally, but let's assume that I'd like to run for office like you did, and you had a very successful career as an elected official. Are there any tips that would be appropriate to share?
Well, I would mention a few. One is to get a good, solid liberal arts education. I mentioned areas such as economics, communication, history as being important. Second, to get as broad a range of personal experience as you can. You mentioned that I did work days while I was governor and in the U.S. Senate. Those were extremely valuable to me, particularly to understand how other people viewed their lives and the communities and world in which they lived. A simple recommendation: if you've done an internship last year and you really liked it, and you now have an opportunity to go back and do it again this next summer, reject that. Find something else to do this next summer so that you're not just layering on to one experience, you're multiplying the range of opportunities that you've availed yourself of. So those would be a couple of suggestions that would help prepare people who are interested in elected public office.
Well, I think I appreciate that, and I think we're going to have to leave it at that, Senator.
Thank you very much.
If you would like additional information about Senator Bob Graham or the Bob Graham Center for Public Service, please visit bobgrahamcenter.ufl.edu. If you have comments or suggestions about higher education today, please send an email to our viewer mailbox at higher education today@topcolleges.com. Thank you for watching. We will continue to bring you quality discussions about important matters in today's college and university world. Please join me again for another edition of Higher Education Today. I'm Steven Roy Goodman, and you've been watching Higher Education Today.